Pressure increases on Donald Trump as a stream of allegations emerge about him groping women. He says the claims are false and singles out one woman for particular scorn.
Take a look. You take a look. Look at her. Look at her words. You tell me what you think. I don't think so. I don't think so.
The U.S. First Lady weighs into the row, accusing Trump of sexually predatory behavior.
The belief that you can do anything you want to a woman, it is cruel. It's frightening.
We'll be looking at what effect the growing controversy is having on the race for the White House. Also tonight...
No one will have the right to deny Scotland the chance to choose a better future.
Nicola Sturgeon makes her strongest bid yet for a second referendum on Scottish independence. The standoff between Tesco and Unilever is over, but could other Brexit price rises be on the way? New safety concerns at two-thirds of A&E departments in hospitals in England. John is in a basement mixing up the medicine. And Bob Dylan joins the likes of Hemingway and Steinbeck to win the Nobel Prize for Literature.
In the south, the UN calls for the release of a British charity worker detained in Iran since April. And they're the best days of your life, so should they be longer? Plans to extend the school day.
Good evening. The US First Lady Michelle Obama has launched a scathing attack on the Republican presidential candidate Donald Trump, accusing him of sexually predatory behaviour that is shocking and demeaning to women. Meanwhile, women have been lining up to accuse Trump of groping and harassing them. Tonight, the billionaire businessman has gone on the offensive, denouncing all the claims as absolutely false. Our North America editor John Soper reports on an increasingly bitter US election campaign.
This woman talking to the New York Times recounts how she was on a flight and moved to first class. She found herself sitting next to Donald Trump.
He was like an octopus. It was like he had six arms. He was all over the place. When he started putting his hand up my skirt, and that was it. That was it. I was out of there.
Two of the claims that emerged last night concerned alleged sexual misconduct by Mr. Trump at his Mar-a-Lago mansion in Florida. One woman, a writer for People magazine, had gone to interview him and his wife for a piece on their first wedding anniversary. Melania Trump was heavily pregnant and had gone upstairs to change when the reporter claims Mr. Trump pounced. Natasha Stoynoff writes, "We walked into that room alone and Trump shut the door behind us. I turned round and within seconds he was pushing me against the wall and forcing his tongue down my throat. He was fast, taking me by surprise and throwing me off balance. I was stunned." But at a rally in Florida, Donald Trump painted himself as the victim, where everyone was ganging up on him, and he furiously dismissed the allegations.
"These claims are all fabricated. They're pure fiction and they're outright lies. These events never, ever happened, and the people that said them meekly fully understand. You take a look at these people. You study these people, and you'll understand also."
So why are all these stories appearing now? Trump supporters are convinced there is effectively a conspiracy between the liberal media and the Clinton campaign. But this many stories from so many different outlets from across the country? Well, the women themselves have a simpler explanation. They were enraged by Trump's denial at the third time of asking in Sunday's presidential debate that he'd ever made unwanted sexual advances towards women.
"Just for the record, though, are you saying that what you said on that bus 11 years ago, that you did not actually kiss women without consent or grope women without consent?"
"I have great respect for women, tremendous respect for women.
Have you ever done those things?"
"And women have respect for me. And I will tell you, no, I have not.
I just start kissing them. It's like a magnet. You just kiss."
Michelle Obama, for one, though, isn't buying the line that it was just idle chat on that bus.
"And this wasn't just locker room banter. This was a powerful individual speaking freely and openly about sexually predatory behavior. and actually bragging about kissing and groping women, using language so obscene that many of us were worried about our children hearing it when we turn on the TV.
And these comments to a group of 10-year-olds at Trump Tower aren't helping his case.
I'm going to be dating her in 10 years. Can you believe
it? I'm offended almost every time he opens his mouth, and I don't like him at all. I don't respect him.
He's awful. He's against women. He's always talking, putting women down.
I think he's a scumbag.
Donald Trump is doing everything he can to switch attention away from himself and making this about a system that he says is rigged.
Well, John, Donald Trump has come out fighting. As you're saying, he's hitting back hard against these allegations. Are you getting any sense there that the tide is beginning to turn now?
Fiona, if you just look at the situation on the ground, we learnt today that a key battleground state, Virginia, Donald Trump is pulling resources from there. In Wisconsin, another swing state, his polling numbers among women have fallen through the floor since those comments last week. And in other battleground states, it's pretty much the same story. But Donald Trump is trying to say, look, I may be about to lose this election, it seems, but there are reasons for it. And what he did today was give you a full-scale conspiracy theory. In terms, he said, the media, along with Wall Street, along with major corporations, were working in concert to deny the American people a Trump victory. And he said at the epicenter of this conspiracy was Hillary Clinton. And he said he posed an existential threat to the American system. And he went on, they, the media, will seek to destroy everything about you, including your reputation. But he said, I am prepared to take the slings and arrows for you, my supporters. Now, one other thing important to add, the numbers attending his rallies have not dipped at all. The enthusiasm for him of those attending is still as great. And the numbers of people in America who believe the message that there is this conspiracy is still significant. It's just not significant enough at the moment to deliver Donald Trump a presidential election victory.
John Sobel, the White House, thank you. Scotland's First Minister, Nicola Sturgeon, has made her strongest move yet for a second referendum on independence. She's announced that consultation on legislation for a new referendum will start next week. She told the SNP conference in Glasgow that the Scottish people should be able to reconsider independence in the light of the Brexit vote. Well, our Scotland editor Sarah Smith is in Glasgow for us tonight. Sarah, given this is just a consultation at this stage, how significant would you say it is?
Well, Nicola Sturgeon is making preparations for a second referendum on Scottish independence without definitely saying that she will call for one, because the truth is she is not certain that if that vote were to happen soon that she would win it. But nonetheless, she did want to send a clear message today that she is prepared to consider another vote, that she's considering doing it within the next 2 years if she judges that's what's necessary to protect Scotland's interests.
Welcome the leader of the Scottish National Party and First Minister of Scotland, Nicola Sturgeon.
Do not be confused by the coy smile. Nicola Sturgeon is angry, and she didn't mince her words today, accusing the Tories of xenophobia, calling them a disgrace, and delivering a stark warning that if the UK government doesn't listen to her on Brexit, she is prepared to hold another referendum on Scottish independence.
If you think for one single second that I am not serious about doing what it takes to protect Scotland's interests, then think again. I can confirm today that the independence referendum bill will be published for consultation next week.
Party members were as delighted as they were surprised. Nicola Sturgeon's speech here in Glasgow was really a direct message to the Prime Minister in Downing Street, a clear warning that if Theresa May doesn't listen to her concerns about Brexit, then Sturgeon could demand a second referendum on independence. SNP members are accustomed to being told to be patient, not to rush into a referendum they might lose, but the mood of the party leadership clearly changed.
Is this a threat to the Prime Minister that she must listen to the Scottish Government or they will call a second referendum on independence?
No, it's a promise to the Prime Minister. We promise that we will stand up for the interests of people in this country. We will do everything that we have to do to protect our place in Europe. It's a promise.
Including another referendum.
If that's what it takes, that's what we'll do.
Outside the conference centre, the landscape looks a little different. Polls suggest no significant increase in support for independence. Since the fall in the oil price, the economic outlook is far more challenging. But Nicola Sturgeon says it's a hard Brexit that will damage the Scottish economy.
Here in Scotland, 80,000 jobs could be lost. Wages would be hit by up to £2,000 and growth in the economy would slow.
Just along the Clyde, in the Riverside Museum, Scottish voters have their own ideas about what Nicola Sturgeon should prioritise.
Work on getting us independence from England.
People of Scotland voted to stay in the UK, and then the people of the UK voted to stay to get out of Europe. So you've got to listen to that.
I suppose there's nothing much we can do about Brexit now, is there? But you've got to make sure you've got a good NHS and you've got a good education system.
If voters think that making plans for another vote on independence means the Scottish Government might neglect the country's schools or hospitals, that certainly won't help them win a referendum. Sarah Smith, BBC News, Glasgow.
The battle over the cost of Brexit between Britain's biggest supermarket, Tesco, and the consumer goods giant Unilever is over. Unilever had wanted to push up the price of its products like Marmite and pot noodle because of the sharp fall in the value of the pound following the vote to leave the EU. This evening, both companies said the situation had been resolved. As our economics editor Kamal Ahmed reports, there may be more price hikes to come.
Tonight, a sort of uneasy peace. Tesco and Unilever agreed that price rises demanded by the maker of Marmite, Ben & Jerry's and Persil were off the table, at least for the moment. A row over who should pay for the pound's 17% fall in value since the referendum had reached a truce.
What we're seeing here is a supermarket in the UK and an importer in the UK basically arguing over who is going to accept the cost to them of the falling pound, because neither of them really want to pass it on to customers if they can avoid it, but they don't want to absorb it into their own profits.
Unilever's claim was simple. It's costing us more to import goods. We need 10% higher prices from Tesco to compensate. Tesco said no, and suddenly some of Britain's most famous brands disappeared from Tesco online. This has certainly been a PR victory for Tesco. In the past, it hasn't always been seen as on the side of the shopper, and I am told it was Unilever which backed down.
This is not just an argument between a supplier of Marmite and a very big supermarket. Its implications go far wider. Yes, we import a lot of food, but we also import a lot of other things, like fuel. And there, prices are already starting to rise.
We could be on a new road towards inflation, price rises, as what Britain imports becomes more expensive. In the 1970s, inflation approached 30%, and since then has been on a gradual downward march. After the financial crisis, the economy slowed so rapidly, inflation dipped below 0%. But with sterling falling in value, many economists believe inflation could be on the way up again, as high as 3% by the end of next year.
Ultimately, there may be inflation coming into the UK economy, and that means government has got to redouble its efforts to invest in infrastructure to counter that effect. And if they can do that, if we can find other ways to grow, then that will more than offset any of the problems that might be caused by inflation coming through from Brexit.
He says stopping the jams and investing in major projects like road improvements will boost the economy. And if the economy is strong, then wage growth is strong. That makes inflation less damaging. And we could be doing a lot more of this. I'm back in Britain, yes, I'm back in Britain. A 1990s campaign for Made in Britain, suddenly appealing again as imports become more expensive. Speaking today, the government insisted the economy is strong.
There are a whole host of things that companies are looking at in terms of their investments. And I think what's really encouraging for all of us is that since the vote on the 23rd of June, we've continued to see strong investment into the UK.
No price rises yet for these shoppers, but the battle between Tesco and Unilever is a sign of something much larger. If inflation does rise, that will bring the effects of the fall in the pound into everyone's living room. Kamal Ahmed, BBC News.
there are safety concerns about two-thirds of A&E departments in hospitals in England, according to the watchdog, the Care and Quality Commission. It's blaming the crisis in care in A&E mainly on a lack of care for the elderly, which is causing a rise in emergency admissions and overcrowding in hospitals. It's a view echoed by England's most senior emergency doctor, who says the NHS is on its knees and parts will implode this winter. Dominic Hughes reports.
I'm Dr. Postma, I'm one of the emergency doctors here. How are you doing?
Not very good.
Not feeling so well?
Another challenging day at the Queen's Hospital in Romford. It has one of the biggest emergency departments in the country, and there's no respite, no let-up.
It's very, very busy. We have vast numbers of patients coming in through the doors. In a place like this, we can see up to 600-700 patients in one day. So the numbers is definitely a big issue, shall I say.
The last CQC inspection here said the department needed to improve, but the pressure is unrelenting. There are problems recruiting staff, but more patients, many old and frail, are turning to A&E for help.
The Queen's Hospital here in Romford is not alone. The latest CQC report shows that a rising demand for services and very tight budgets means hundreds of hospitals across England are struggling to cope.
Today's report looks at the state of care across the health and social care system in England. Nearly two-thirds of A&E units were judged to be inadequate or requiring improvement when it comes to safety. And hospitals are seeing many more older people. Admissions of those over 85 have increased by a third in the past decade. But there's also been a 26% drop in the number of older people getting care from councils over the past 4 years.
People who should be getting adult social care, they're either not getting a service or they're presenting to the NHS. So we see accidents emergency attendances up, emergency referrals being up, and particularly older people delayed in hospital.
This could be part of the answer to easing the pressure on hospitals. Granby Hub in Liverpool offers care to those like Ellen McNaught, who was well enough to be discharged from hospital but still too frail to go home. But even here, there's a logjam. What was meant to be a four-week stay for Ellen has become 4 months.
I need two carers at least to use this equipment and help me. So other people probably need the same. You know, we just can't get carers. So we're taking places up like this where people could come in and get that little bit of respite they desperately need.
Okay, just relax your arm.
The Department of Health says the system is coping well given the pressures, but leading doctors point to waiting times in A&E this summer that were worse than in most recent winters.
During these winter months, we're going to see extreme pressures on hospital, and I think we could see hospitals falling over as we face the winter pressures.
The picture today is one of a system that's on the edge. Dominic Hughes, BBC News.
Bob Dylan has won the Nobel Prize for Literature. It's the first time in 115 years of the prize that the award has been given to a musician. The legendary singer-songwriter now ranks alongside former winners and giants of literature such as Hemingway, Steinbeck and Sartre. Dylan was awarded the accolade for having created new poetic expressions within the great American song tradition. Our arts editor, Will Gompers, has a story. John is in a basement
mixing up the medicine. As Bob Dylan has said himself, he has a way with words. His lyrics have been sung, quoted and discussed the world over, and today earned him the Nobel Prize for Literature.
Bob Dylan.
It came as a surprise.
For having created new poetic expressions within the great American song tradition.
You got a sense that the austere Swedish Academy was stepping out of its literary comfort zone.
Does Bob Dylan really deserve a Nobel Prize? Why?
Why? Well, of course he does. He just got it.
There was, though, advice for the uninitiated.
If you want to start listening or reading, you may start with Blonde on Blonde, the album from 1966. You've got many classics, and it's an extraordinary example of his brilliant way of rhyming and putting together refrains and his pictorial thinking. Like a woman.
Bob Dylan's position as an iconic musician who helped elevate the status of pop music from an ephemeral, disposable entertainment, and don't speak too soon, but the wheel's still in spin, into a bona fide art form is well established. The answer is blowing in the wind. But becoming a Nobel laureate takes him into another realm, to join an elite group of the world's greatest literary writers, from novelist Alice Munro to the late poet T.S. Eliot.
His work is timeless, and it's going to reverberate for not just years or decades, for centuries. And in that, I do think it's incredibly valid that he's gets the Nobel Prize for Literature. This is not someone that's a song and dance man, although he made that joke once that he was.
Do you think of yourself primarily as a singer or as a poet?
Well, I think of myself more as a song and dance man, you know. To make you
feel my love. Adele wasn't even born when he said that. Yet here she is, like so many before, singing his words. Bob Dylan, like Shakespeare, has that knack for coining a phrase that becomes part of everyday speech. He has his own literary voice, his own sense of meter and rhyme, metaphor and meaning. He is a contemporary chronicler, storyteller, moralist and poet whose work and words have changed attitudes and lives. Will Gomperz, BBC News.
The newly elected head of the United Nations has said with so many conflicts around the globe, we're facing a very difficult moment in the history of our world. António Guterres, a former Prime Minister of Portugal, said the conflict in Syria is breaking his heart and that he'll fight for peace. But with the city of Aleppo plunged into some of the worst violence in the country's five-year civil war, what can the UN and Mr. Guterres do? He's been speaking to our chief international correspondent, Lise Doucette.
The world's most powerful club, tasked with ending the world's most punishing war. For five long years, the UN utterly failed Syria. On its watch, millions displaced or dead. A country destroyed.
It is so decided.
Now a new man to take on what's called the most impossible job on earth. António Guterres, former Portuguese Prime Minister, former UN refugee chief. For years, he berated the world to do more for refugees.
Because the Syrians would deserve much more.
Now he must focus on stopping the wars which force them to flee.
Mr. Guterres?
As promised.
But as he gives his first interview, some, including Britain's foreign secretary, say there's more talk of military options for Syria.
The role of the Secretary General is to try to be an honest broker, is to try to be a messenger for peace, is to try to be a bridge builder.
Do you fear more war, that there will be more war in Syria, that we haven't seen the worst yet?
I hope not, I sincerely hope not, because we have seen such a terrible level of suffering that to think that this will even get worse is
your job is to end it now.
I believe that it is the international community's first priority is to be able to end this conflict and then to use the momentum created by it to try to address all the other conflicts that are interlinked.
The biggest of barriers, the deeply divided UN Security Council. It showed rare unity backing Mr. Guterres for the job. But Russia's top diplomat tells me, don't expect change in the UN's most powerful body.
He cannot do much about the Security Council, you know, he is not in charge of the Security Council. The Security Council is in charge of itself, and unfortunately, on some issues, there are very dramatic contradictions which cannot be bridged.
Today, from the U.S., a call for Mr. Guterres to strengthen this house.
The countries of the world, here reflecting, I believe, the longings and the urgent needs of our citizens, are calling on the UN and by extension the Secretary General to do more than this institution has ever done before.
In the midst of war, the world's people.
71 years ago, the UN emerged from the ashes of war with a promise of peace. Competing interests shaped it from the start. They're all backing Mr. Guterres now, but he knows big battles lie ahead. Lise Doucette, BBC News, New York.
Let's take a brief look at some of the day's other news stories. The Nigerian government says that 21 schoolgirls kidnapped more than 2 years ago by Islamist militants have been freed. Boko Haram abducted more than 270 girls from a school in Chibok in northeast Nigeria. The government has denied four imprisoned militants were released in exchange. Figures from the Home Office show a sharp rise in the reports of hate crime after the EU referendum. The statistics from police forces in England and Wales show a 41% increase in offences in July compared to the same month in 2015. A High Court case has begun about whether the government needs Parliament's approval to leave the European Union. One of the lead claimants is investment fund manager Gina Miller, who wanted the UK to stay in the EU. The government called it an attempt to stifle the will of the people. A gorilla is safely back in its enclosure after escaping at London Zoo this afternoon. Visitors were locked inside cafes while armed police were called to the scene. The zoo said the gorilla, called Kumbuka, had got into a secure keeper's area. He was tranquilised and returned to his enclosure. The world's longest reigning monarch, the King of Thailand, has died at the age of 88. It's prompted an outpouring of grief across the country. Revered as the father of the nation, the king is considered by many Thai people to be a demigod. The country will now observe a period of mourning lasting a whole year. His death means the Queen is now the world's longest serving monarch. Our South Asia correspondent, Jonathan Head, reports from Bangkok.
It was a moment everyone here knew was coming, but few had wanted to accept. The long expected announcement from the palace that the king who had reigned and inspired them for 70 years had died. Still the cry went out. Long live the king, but he'd gone.
Well, we've seen an intensely emotional reaction here to the news of King Bhumibol's death. The unquestioned reverence for the monarchy in Thailand is not what it was, but the emotional bond that people across this country feel to a man they still refer to as father of the nation remains largely unbroken. His death will leave an enormous void, one which may well have consequences for this country's political stability.
He'd acceded to the throne when the monarchy was weak and Thailand an undeveloped rural country. But by allying himself with a succession of military governments, he rebuilt the monarchy's prestige, tapping into Thai traditions of semi-divine kingship. Yet he was passionately interested in rural development, travelling extensively to promote his own projects. During the Cold War, he used his royal stature to help shore up the central government against a tenacious communist insurgency. He's credited with mediating several political crises. Yet later in his reign, the monarchy was accused of taking sides in conflicts. By the time of his death, he'd been out of public sight for years. Royal influence had dwindled. Yet many Thais remember him as the ruler who brought them stability and prosperity. And they're still grateful. Jonathan Head, BBC News, Bangkok.
She's the poster girl of British track and field, a world champion, Olympic champion at London 2012, and she won silver, of course, at Rio this year. But today, Jessica Ennis-Hill announced her retirement from athletics. The heptathlete said she'd made some amazing memories and wanted to leave on a high. Natalie Perks reports.
Ambassador, role model, champion. Jessica Ennis-Hill has packed more into her career than most of us could dream of. But she knows that now is the time to say goodbye. In a statement, she said, "This has been one of the toughest decisions I've had to make, but I know that retiring now is right. I've always said I want to leave my sport on a high and have no regrets, and I can truly say that." She'd already been the heptathlon world champion, but London 2012 was her defining moment. On Super Saturday, the nation held its breath as Ennis-Hill cemented her status as its poster girl.
Jessica Ennis is the Olympic champion.
It catapulted her into a world of celebrity and, of course, gave Sheffield a golden postbox. After the Olympics, though, came a different challenge, becoming a wife and then mother to son Reggie. Yet she came back to become world champion again last year, and in Rio, a silver medal made the tears flow as she battled this decision.
I'm really emotional, and you know, I've got to go away now and make a big decision as to what I do, and I don't want to cry on TV, but yeah, these years have been amazing, so just really proud. Didn't she give
it everything? Those who know the pressure of competing at the highest level understand just why she's bowed out at the very top.
Well, this was the scene of her greatest triumph, and fans were hoping to see more of her next year when London hosts the World Athletics Championships. But those who've competed under the same pressure say they understand just why she's bowed out at the very top.
She's achieved something that most athletes only ever dream about. So she's had a fantastic career. You know, now she's got the next however many years ahead, hopefully being inspirational and supportive and motivational for many people to come.
Humble, hard-working, but fiercely determined, Ennis Hill will go down in British sporting history as the ultimate all-rounder. Natalie Perks, BBC News.
Now, Newsnight is about to begin over on BBC Two in a few moments. Here's Emily.
Tonight, a Syrian refugee who moved to Britain on trial for sexual assault. Newsnight's followed him and his family for a year and is with them as the verdict comes through. Join me now on BBC Two, 11 p.m. in Scotland.
And that's it from us here on BBC One. Now it's time for the news where you are. Bye-bye.